What's up, everybody? Welcome to IGN Game Scoop. I'm your host, Damon Hatfield. Joining me this week are Sam Claiborne.
Is this the show? Are we starting the show?
This is the show. Justin Davis is on the show.
Right. Scoop. Scoop.
And Per Schneider is on the show this week.
I wasn't ready yet. I hadn't grown hair yet and stuff.
You have to be ready to scoop at any moment, Per. That's how I live my life.
He keeps us on his toes.
At the drop of a hat. And we've got a great show for you this week. You know, Baldur's Gate is out, and everyone, I think except me, is playing it. I'm just waiting for the PS5 version to come out. I'm very excited to play it. It's just the talk of the town in the gaming community. And it's got everyone really excited about RPGs, and that we thought that would be a good opportunity to pick. We're just going to pick the best three RPGs from every console. That's what we're doing this week. Great. And every console has a little asterisk on it. We will not be picking any RPGs from the Philips CD-i or the 3DO. Okay, so, sorry to all of you fans out there, but I was able to find an example of an RPG on the Atari 2600.
That's really pretty cool.
Which one?
Hold on. We'll get there.
Oh, okay.
But first, as I said last week, I did go to Chuck E. Cheese.
We had
my son's 4-year-old birthday party there, and it was great. Everybody had a great time. The adults had a great time. The kids had a great time. It was great. Some observations, though. Not one classic arcade game. There was no arcade game that was probably more than 10, 12 years old.
Okay. Wow. All Redemption?
They all run on cards. So like you get, we have like 2 hours of unlimited play. Everyone has a card and you just scan your card and that's how. So maybe that's why they don't have any classic arcade games.
Do they all shoot out tickets? Are they redemption games?
So now your tickets are stored in your card.
The tickets are on the card.
Yeah.
But my point is, do all the games get played for a prize or there's some you just play to play?
Some you just play to play. But there are a great many that you earn tickets for, which is great to have unlimited play because then you're just earning tickets, nonstop. It is a little bit of a bummer for the kids not to have this like physical like clump of tickets, but I get it. Yeah.
Is there skee-ball?
There was skee-ball. Yes.
Okay. Well, that's at least a classic-ish game. It's just the model was new.
So was it all like Raw Fury updates and additions, like Redemption Machines? Like they seem to have specialized in that recently.
Did they have any of the Namco big ones like the giant Space Invaders or
they had the big Galaga? But it was out of service.
It's all mobile games, right? It's like Doodle Jump.
There's Angry Birds. There was Flappy Bird. There's Fruit Ninja. That worked out great. Kingo knows all those games, so he's happy.
What about claw games? Any of those? Like,
yeah, they had some claw games and kind of like high tech versions of claw games too.
And those are fun.
They had a tiny toddler kid sized air hockey table, which was great.
How was the ambiance? Was it like what I was I told
just
Damon
horrifying
we were talking before.
Animatronics.
Well, they don't do animatronics. They have a big video wall and they just play videos.
Okay, what videos of?
Of like the characters.
Really?
Yeah.
Cool.
Chuck E. Cheese, which I forget. Have we talked about this on the show? Does anyone know what Chuck E.'s full name is?
Yeah, Charles Entertainment Cheese. Yeah.
Charles Entertainment Cheese is his full name. They did bring him out.
We've met many times.
The kids were all scared at first, but then they warmed up.
I mean, he's a giant rat. He doesn't look cute.
Hey, he was retconned to be a mouse, I'll have you know. Did you discover any interesting diseases in the ball pit?
There was no ball pit, so problem solved.
The ball pit was a video wall.
Yeah, no ball pit. And the most popular game with the kids is a version of a game we talked about fairly recently, Pain, that early PlayStation Network game for PS3 where you launch a guy into buildings and try to cause as much damage. There's like a ripoff of that you launch him with like a dynamite
plunger?
Activator or igniter, whatever you call that, like in a cartoon if they set off dynamite. You push that and then the guy would launch. That was the most fun thing for the kids.
I thought you were talking to like when I was a kid at carnivals, you had this game called Pain where you hold metal bars and it'll electrocute you. And like you had to hold on as long as possible. There's like a meter going and like it would get worse and worse. It was probably really good for you.
Yeah, probably.
Didn't have that?
Was it
actually painful?
Yeah, it was awful. Man, it really hurt.
There's a game at Free Gold Watch that's a drunk test game, and it's like because you reminded me of Operation. It's a long metal bar that's like S-shaped and all complicated, and then you have a little loop of that you that goes over it, but the loop is it can't touch that metal bar, so you have to trace the whole metal bar. Was that in your parents' bar, Justin?
It's from Japan. No. It's called Irritating Electric Stick.
Nice.
No joke.
Yes, I remember that, but the version I saw rotated. It was slowly spinning.
Oh my gosh. Really?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Wow.
Well, anyway, Chuck E. Cheese was great.
Just real quick, the ambience. Was it like gray carpet and white walls, or was it like pizza booths and like, you know, psychedelic carpets?
Yeah, well, it's not psychedelic. It was like purple. Everything was like purplish, and there were booths.
Purple,
yeah,
okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
They set us up at a long table. The pizza was not bad. Some of the adults there said the pizza was really good. I wouldn't go that far. I think it was surprisingly.
It was pizza.
Bad.
What about the beer?
Oh, that was the bit. That was the one disappointment. No beer.
Oh,
are you kidding me?
There was no beer.
You were promised beer.
There was a moment of panic when we all arrived. Like, hold on. There's no beer for the adults, but everyone had a good time.
But we both heard that there's good pizza and beer at Chuck E. Cheese.
I know. Not at this one.
I know that everyone on Scoop knows this, but for Scoop Nation that might not know this, Chuck E. Cheese founded by Atari founder Nolan Bushnell.
Bushnell. Yep.
It's crazy. Yeah. And like if you would ask anyone on Earth in the 90s, is like, will Chuck E. Cheese still be around and doing well 30 years from now? 100 out of 100 people would be like, no, this place is on the way out. But like, they've turned it around.
There's a I grew up in Iowa, and there it was Showbiz. We had Showbiz Pizza.
So
we had
they bought them out.
Yeah, and it was like Showbiz. They had the same slogan, Showbiz Pizza, where a kid can be a kid. And it was in Cedar Rapids. I never went. Maybe
it's vice versa. Showbiz bought out Chuck E. Cheese renamed every Showbiz. They took the Chuck E. Cheese brand, even though they bought them out.
For a while,
they operated both brands, and then they just turned everything into Chuck E. Cheese.
But Showbiz's band was the Rockafire Explosion.
Yes.
Was the documentary name.
So, I might still have a couple of their records around, too.
And that band's great.
If you're interested in the entire sordid Chuck E. Cheese story, John Oliver did an amazing
piece. Oh, it's so good.
I think it's for free on YouTube. You can
it
watch
is.
It.
It's on its own so site. Good. It's a standalone site with just that video, because he did an episode on mortgages, and he said, hey, nobody under like 35 are going to care or know anything about what we're talking about this episode. So I made an episode just for you all to learn what Chuck E. Cheese is.
It's amazing. It's so good. Please watch it.
It's so enthralling. It pulls you in from the beginning. It's like a 25-minute, 30-minute watch. It's so good. And by the way, California Extremes this weekend, the big arcade convention in Northern California here. I'm going to go on Saturday, maybe Sunday. They had the full Rockafire Explosion band set up, just blasting horrible music the whole time. And it was like, that place is already loud. There's like a din. And it's really fun, like a Vegas, you know, slot machine area. You can picture what that sounds like if you've ever been to Vegas. But that was so crazy loud. You walk by those just jerking robots. We were just going for 18 hours a day. And it was just fascinating.
Cool.
Love it.
All right. RPGs, role-playing games. Right. We're going to name some of the best ones. We're going to try to pick three from all the major platforms. And like I said, I did find one for the Atari 2600. Not three. I think there is exactly one. And it has a great name. It's called Dragon Stomper.
Ooh. Oh, I never played that.
It was out in either late 82 or early 83. And the description on Wikipedia is, the game follows the adventures of a dragon hunter who is given a quest by the king to defeat a dragon and reclaim a magical amulet that was stolen. Player makes his way over the countryside, vanquishing various adversaries and gaining gold and experience. After achieving enough strength, the player can enter a shop in a village where equipment can be purchased, soldiers hired, and special scrolls obtained to defeat the dragon in his lair.
Sounds like an RPG.
Pretty involved for an Atari 2600 game.
Do numbers come out of the enemies, though?
No, but battling is turn-based, and it's done through in-game text menu, choosing to fight, use a spell, use weapons, or attempt to flee.
I was going to say, that description sounded so good, and then we all know that the actual gameplay is just going to be like,
are a dot. You are a dot moving around. Yeah.
I mean, with all the nostalgia around Atari, I think all of us went back and played some of the older Atari games and realized that they were never good.
No.
Yeah.
The 8-bit stuff holds up, but anything earlier than that is
4-bit generation was pretty bad.
I think there are some 7800 games that are still fun, but probably not really any. I mean, maybe River Raid on the 2600.
Yeah.
The interesting thing about Dragon Stomper is it required the use of the Star Path Supercharger, which connected to the Atari in order for it to read a cassette tape.
Wow.
Oh, it was one of those games.
Yeah, so
okay.
That's why they were. Yeah. It was able Never to be so it. More advanced. Dragon Stomper. It's not in the Atari 50 collection, unfortunately.
Yeah, I'm really curious.
I was worried when you brought up this topic that you were going to make us go back to like the Commodore 64 and ZX Spectrum.
No.
Atari 8-bit days. I had an 800 computer and all of that. Yep.
Well, I was talking to Pear about this, and I was like, you know, what did you play any of those PCRPGs? And he's like, yeah, of course. I played, you know, all the stuff. I'm like, what stuff? He's like, you know, the European shit.
Ultima.
Right.
Oh, on my Atari computer, Alternate Reality, that blew my mind.
That was that. That was the end of the conversation. Yeah.
That's it. No. We didn't care about genre. Genres didn't exist back then. They hadn't been invented yet.
Mm.
Everything took 1 hour to load.
So it's interesting, though, to start there, though, because the RPG, you know, started in the United States because it's based on a pen and paper series from Gary Gygax, right?
Yep.
And then it went to Japan and did not come back to the United States very often for a long time in video game form. You know, like the 90s had CRPGs and stuff like that, but like,
yeah.
Boy.
In terms of consoles,
There's like an 85 to 92 zone where it's pretty rough to find RPGs, but we'll talk about them. A lot of them are Japanese. They're awesome.
Yep.
Yeah, except for computer RPGs like Wizardry
and Ultima.
There's this weird diversion. Like the history of the RPG is really fascinating in that way.
Yep. Yeah, there's so many Dungeons and Dragons influences on games in the United States still. It's just if you had an NES, it got really rough there for a while.
Yep. Well, speaking of the NES, you had Final Fantasy, which I think would be my pick for my favorite RPG on the platform.
Yep.
And still the best Final Fantasy.
It's still super playable and fun today. But of course, there were like four or five Dragon Warrior games on the console, which I had less experience with. There's four of them.
Mm-hmm.
I never found those. I think Final Fantasy I holds up better in a modern context than the original Dragon Warrior, Dragon Quest.
And if we're going to talk about those, Final Fantasy I, II, and III came out on the NES. And
yes,
three people really like is the job system.
Three is incredible. I played three. I went through a project. I mean, gosh, it's been 10 or 15 years ago where I wanted to play through all the Final Fantasy games kind of sequentially. But the only way to play two and three, which were never translated into English, would be to play them. I think the DS might have been the first time they were in English. But fans translated the Japanese ROMs into English. Yeah. So you could play the NES version, you know, with questionable legality in English. And that was how I played it, and Final Fantasy III is like legit. It's so good. I don't really have too much more to add, except that it takes everything that I liked about one and adds like it's the first one with an actual real story and characters that you care about. It's good, you know, and you start as Onion Knights, and then like Sam said, you have this job system. It's great.
I didn't own an NES or a Famicom when it first came out, and so I caught up on those games later. Was hugely into Final Fantasy during the 16-bit days, and it struck me how unbalanced and hard they were, right? Like, they were not designed with the sort of, like, the player's comfort in mind, you know? You could easily get overpowered by opponents. But it is really cool to go back because you can see how, you know, 1, 2, 3, kind of like, they were figuring out what Final Fantasy was to become. Like, the first one didn't even have chocobos in it or anything, right? Like, I think the second one introduced them.
It did have an airship,
system,
though.
And the third one. It did have, and like, two added Cid, I think, for the first time. So you had them just kind of trying out different things until, like, three pretty much nailed the concept for what 4 and 5 would do. It's still fun.
I guess we should just go ahead and count imps as part something that's in every Final Fantasy as well. And then there's two other Japanese. Well, go ahead. More Final Fantasy.
Oh, sorry. I didn't mean to interrupt. I was just going to say, don't forget about Star Tropics.
That was another one to mention.
There's some weird ones. Yeah, before I get to the other good ones, Crystalis Fazanadu, as we're supposed to call it now.
Yeah.
Because it's a mashup of
fantasy.
Xanadu and fantasy. Yeah.
Don't be tricked into forgetting a major, well-known role-playing game that released on the NES that people sometimes think isn't one, and that's Zelda 2.
I was going to ask about Zelda 2.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, I mean, if Xanadu counts, then Zelda 2 does.
It's the lone role-playing game in the Legend of Zelda series, although, you know, by modern standards, like, if you're rolling in your Borderlandses and Assassin's Creeds, you know, Tears of the Kingdom, Kingdom, Breath of the Wild have a lot of RPG systems, but they weren't focused on that sort of leveling up with numbers and stats the way that, you know, Zelda 2 was. So,
Then,
great soundtrack, good game.
And every name that's been used in every Zelda game since started in that game. It's either names of people or villages, but they're in everything now. Two games that I think would be in absolutely people's top threes that we should just mention are Mother, which I don't care for, and and Fire Emblem Gaiden, which is the first Fire Emblem, which is pretty fun.
Yeah,
it's difficult, but it's kind of like amazing that it was pulled off on the NES. But, you know, I think we could safely at this point just say Final Fantasy 1, 2, and 3. Well, maybe 1 and 3 and pick another one would be the top 3.
Hey, would you put
Zelda 2 in there? I know that game's kind of divisive.
Yeah. I love it.
I would, yeah. I think it's only divisive, though, because it's a departure from 1 and 3 went back to the formula.
It's really hard. Everybody plays it with save states now. Yeah. And so that makes it fun. But you will not beat that last boss without it. And I know people did back then, but try it now. It's very difficult.
Yeah.
I was gone for a second. I don't know.
Not
just that I had nothing to say about Zelda 2.
We enjoyed it,
But I am back. So anyway, sorry. We can continue on. All seems well. I'm back in our recording stuff. So
okay.
You missed the whole Star Tropics 2 conversation.
Well, if we're including games that weren't released in North America at the time, then I know what some of us are going to be picking for the Super Nintendo then.
But yeah, so if we had to pick three, I'd say Final Fantasy 1, 3, and maybe Zelda 2.
Yeah.
Cool. I'm good with that.
Wildcard.
I like it.
So it is.
Sorry, Earthbound fans. I know people.
So it shall be done. Sorry, Willow.
You finally got Earthbound Beginnings in English. So
sorry, Fester's Quest.
Oh, man.
Sorry for all those ports of Wizardry and Ultima games on the NES.
Oh, those are rough. Bard's Tale?
That's right. They're bad.
Afaria? Yeah. I can keep going.
We need to mention the Sega Master System because Phantasy Star.
Oh, my gosh.
Began there.
Yeah. People freak out about that game.
That game's really good. I mean,
and don't you like Shining Force, Damon?
I do, but it was on the Genesis.
That's Genesis.
Yeah,
that's
later. Sorry. Yeah, that's right. So Shining Force 1 was also in the Genesis, but wasn't a Master?
Yes.
Okay, got it. All right.
Yep.
I think I can handle the TurboGrafx-16 myself.
Do it.
It's probably Ease 1 and 2 and Dungeon Explorer. Ease 1 and 2 is like they came packaged together. At the time of release, GamePro said Ease 1 and 2 has got it all, including great graphics, engaging RPG gameplay, and a brain-draining quest, as well as stunning music and excellent animation sequences.
Mm.
Because it came on a CD that could have real animation and great music.
Why does it have 1 and 2? It's just because that was the bundle that was on the TurboGrafx.
Yeah, I think they'd been released separately on the PC Engine.
Yeah.
So over here, they bundled them together. And Electronic Gaming Monthly awarded the best RPG video game and best music and sound in a video game that year.
Nice. Mm.
And Dungeon Explorer is, it was from Atlas, an early Atlas game, and it's the same team that would go on to make the Megami Tensei games. So, like, from Dungeon Explorer, you can find your way to Persona.
Yeah, that's really neat.
Game Boy.
Oh, we're doing handhelds, too.
Yeah, why not?
Mm-hmm.
Well, you got Pokemon, you got Final Fantasy Adventure, which is the first Mana game, and then pick your favorite Final Fantasy Legend. Mine is 3.
I was going to say, you think 2? I was going to say maybe 2. Final Fantasy.
Three, you go inside a person, which is kind of neat, but they're all weird. Ooh. They're weird games. They're all
weird games.
Pokemon defined role-playing games for me on Game Boy or handheld gaming in general. And I played Red, Blue, and Green. Green was the Japan-only edition that we never got over here. But I think the best one out of that bunch was the Yellow GBC remake. But you consider that a different platform?
No, GBC is the same. You could play it on Game Boy.
Yeah.
There's also Gold and Silver on that era.
Mm. Right.
That's a lot of Pokemon right there. But Pokemon, Red, Green, Yellow, Blue are all top notch.
I would like to submit for your consideration Mario Golf.
Cool.
I mean, would you count it? I think it is an RPG. It's like a golf RPG.
Yeah, well, I've never played the Game Boy one.
And Mario Tennis.
Like that? Mario Tennis is like that too, yeah. But I just like golf better.
Those games are great.
Hmm.
Yep. I played the GBA ones overshadow the original Game Boy ones for me. Game Boy Color ones.
Well, that's really neat. But yeah, if we had to pick, I think, you know, Final Fantasy Adventure is a kind of the action RPG mana game. Mm-hmm. I would throw that in there, but otherwise it could just be basically two eras of Pokemon and pick your poison.
Well, you'd pick Pokemon Yellow.
Yeah, I like on the GBC, but obviously Gold and Silver are better.
I would say, Pokemon Yellow. I would pick Final Fantasy Legend 2 and Mario Golf.
Okay.
Okay. All
right. That's a good list.
Yeah.
Okay.
Sure.
Cool. Okay. Everyone's so agreeable. So Super Nintendo, I was going to kick off the discussion with Chrono Trigger, Final Fantasy VI, and Earthbound, but now we have to talk about Live Alive.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm gonna throw you for a curveball. There are actually a whole bunch of really good games that came out only on the Super Famicom. In the RPG genre, we had Ogre Battle, first of all, that came out over here. Ogre Battle, March of the Black Queen, right?
Great game.
But one of my favorite games of all time is Fire Emblem Monsho no Nazo, which is Mystery of the Emblem. That was amazing. It had two quests in it. It brought back the NES quest, the Famicom quest, and then added a new one. It's a strategy RPG, so it's not pure RPG, right? Yeah.
I can't believe it didn't come out here. It's incredible.
It's insane. It's such a great game. But I personally would pick number one Chrono Trigger, number two Final Fantasy VI, and I love 4 and 5 as well, by the way. Number three, Live Alive, which you lot never got over here.
Yeah.
Until last year.
It's out here now. Yeah. And I still haven't played it yet, but I know Sam likes it a lot.
Ooh, I love it. I spent my year since the 90s telling people how great Live Alive was, and unfortunately you would never get to play it because it'll never be localized. And then, of course, we got that surprise where they brought it back and even reorchestrated some of the music. Great, great soundtrack, but Chrono Trigger still has the best one.
Cool. That sounds great. Chrono Trigger, Final Fantasy VI, and Live Alive.
Yeah, and like the Super NES and / Super Famicom, an amazing role-playing platform.
Yeah,
the entire many saga games. I don't think the Breath of Fire Capcom RPGs are all the way up there, but
no.
Back then when I played them, I really enjoyed them too. Secret of Mana, we actually in Japan we got Seiken Densetsu 3, which was it called here now? Trials of Mana.
It is seriously an amazing Super Nintendo game.
It's such a great game.
If more people played it, it would be in top threes. It is as beautiful as Final Fantasy VI. It's more action-oriented. It's from that Chrono Trigger Final Fantasy VI era of, like, you know, Enix Square graphics, which, like, look amazing. That game has, like, all that parallax and, like, cool cliffs you're overhanging with, like, monsters. It's just, like, it's incredible. That game is a lost game that you can now play in the Mana collection, and they ported and translated it officially.
It was that end of the Super Nintendo era where, you know, the cartridge costs were seriously becoming a problem for publishers, and they were worried to order, you know, 100,000 cartridges from Nintendo and have them not sell in the US, and the size of the cartridge storage became much, much bigger too for the later games, right? And so Square Enix skipped a lot of the later games. Live Alive was too much of a gamble. They didn't bring it out here either.
And then, of course, our audience will clamor for Mario RPG and Earthbound. Those are the other two top ones.
Oh, yeah. I forgot to even mention Mario RPG, right?
Big top games.
Damon mentioned Earthbound. That's on your list, right?
I was going to bring it up, yeah. I do like Earthbound a lot.
I love Final Fantasy V. I think it has one of the most beautiful soundtracks in the history of the series. We've got, you know, 4 and 5 were such fantastic games, but they were overshadowed by 6 because it does a lot of things better than them, but doesn't have the cool job system.
Yeah, no jobs.
Mm-hmm. I mean, there's so many, like, I don't know that I would put any of these in, like, the top tier. I'm certainly not going to put them above Chrono Trigger. But, like, just the body of work, the body of role-playing games on that platform. Like,
nuts.
There's Terranigma, Soul Blazer, Illusion of Gaia. It's actually pretty good. Like, Dragon Quest V is, it's not my favorite Dragon Quest, but, like, it's a lot of people's favorite Dragon Quest. Like,
Albert Odyssey was on that platform, too. I like that one. Terrible name for a game.
There was a pretty good Lord of the Rings role-playing game on the SNES. Right,
Volume 1, Fellowship of the Ring.
That's right. Yeah. What a machine.
Yeah, no kidding.
And then there was also the Sega Genesis, of course.
Yep.
Got to give a shout-out to Phantasy Star 4. Mm-hmm. It's a big one on that platform. And then
the game's great.
I demand it that Shining Force 2 be on our shortlist.
I can't get those games out.
Well, I mean, it is turn-based strategy. So if you don't like turn-based strategy, they're not going to work for you.
No, Shining Force 2 is awesome. I also really liked, I played Shadowrun on the
Genesis. I was going to mention Shadowrun.
Really liked that. Landstalker, remember that?
Yeah, would you count that as an RPG, though?
It's you know.
Adventure platformer in a fantasy setting.
It's a lot of things. Yeah, you're right.
Same with Beyond Oasis. It's more Zelda 1, you know, than
it's
RPG.
It's a great game.
Yeah,
it's a great game.
I like Beyond Oasis, too.
Action adventure game.
Beautiful art.
Yeah, Shadowrun.
Fantasy Star 4.
Oh, sorry, Fantasy Star 4. Go ahead.
I just like, I think if that game were on the SNES, mm-hmm. like, I think it would be up there as considered one of the all time greats and would be remembered more. You know, like, it's, you know, its science fiction setting is really epic in scope and goes all kinds of places that you don't expect it to go. And as I really, actually, really, really have a soft spot for that game and that entire series. And, you know, I think, just because it's on the Genesis, which is not as known for role-playing games, you know, it gets a little bit left behind in the conversation. Mm.
Yeah, it had some of the best graphics I'd ever seen at the time. Okay, sorry. Go ahead.
No, I just bumped my mic and almost knocked it over. But we're okay.
I would say Phantasy Star 4, Shining Force 2, and Shadowrun.
Good.
Yeah.
Yeah, I wonder why the Genesis didn't chase RPGs more. Just because of their huge success on the Super Nintendo, it's just an interesting.
They were a non-story in Japan. I was living in Tokyo at the time. The Genesis really blew up in the West because of the strength of the sports titles. And I saw a Japanese Genesis called the Mega Drive. Mm-hmm. I owned that. I owned the CD add-on. It just couldn't get its head above the water with the Super Famicom doing so well.
Hmm. I didn't realize that. I didn't realize it was kind of a left behind in Japan situation.
Yeah, no, if you went into a store at the time, which I did, I always traded my games and bought new ones. It was just a wall of Super Famicom, and behind it, another wall of Super Famicom, and a little corner of the Mega Drive.
But Sonic is such a huge character in Japan now. So when did that take off?
Yeah, no, they did push Sonic, and you know, it got a little bit of attention with the CD version as well. But it was not like in the U.S.
Sam, how many RPGs were released for the Virtual Boy?
Well, there's Snow Brothers.
Yeah, not enough. I don't think this is an RPG.
Which is not Snow Brothers. What's it called? Jack Brothers, sorry. Brain thing. It's an Atlus game that's based in the Persona universe that has a little bit of exploration called Jack Brothers.
See, RPGs require you to do two things. Usually look at menus and read text, which hurts if you do it in the Virtual Boy, and spend extended amounts of time with your game. So let's say 10 minutes or more, and after about 12 minutes...
I don't know if you guys know this, but we didn't define what an RPG is. It's actually a really painful game, so they're all RPGs on the Virtual Boy. I would also add that there is a Nestor's Funky Bowling, which might very well have RPG elements in bowling. I don't know that. It stars Howard and Nestor from the comic books.
Yeah. On the PlayStation, would we put Final Fantasy VII or IX? Higher.
I mean, you know what I'm going to say.
Yeah, I think you're going to say 9. I would agree with you.
So I just think 7, I mean, it depends on how you define this list, but 7 was so impactful in its storytelling, right? Like, it's not just that big twist moment. The overall story it told was very different from other RPGs of the time. It's certainly more iconic. By the time 9 came around, I had kind of moved on from that look and that style, and so I didn't get into it as much. But I, you know, I see its merits. I like that game a lot, too.
I think there's maybe an argument to be made that all three should be Final Fantasy games with 7, 9, and Tactics.
I mean, Jared Petty is going to, like, run by there and throw a Suikoden and 2-disc at your head.
Yeah, totally.
No, so am I. You don't need to name drop Jared. Suikoden. I loved them when they were contemporary and when they were new. And I don't even know how, like, I wasn't like that crazy of a hardcore gamer, but I liked role-playing games a lot. And so I must've just picked it up off the shelf at random. And that's how I discovered it. But like, I replayed Suikoden 1 and 2 and did the full 108 Stars of Destiny in both. And, like, it's still incredible. Like, the music is fantastic. Like, they actually don't overstay their welcome. Like, they're not short to the point that you feel shortchanged, but, like, you don't need to spend, like, 70 hours with them. They're awesome. Great to play in 2023.
Whatever happened to the HD remasters?
I think they're still coming.
Yeah, still coming.
And Suikoden 2 in particular has, like, one of the most unhinged, memorable villains of all time. Like, you know, it's hard to do a villain, right? Like, they're either, like, you know, very cold and calculating, or they're just insane, or, like, how do you write a good villain? And, like, you know, it's really memorable. It's the most memorable part of the game. It's, like, what you're kind of fighting against in Suikoden 2.
What's a Suikoden? Yeah.
What is it? Mm-hmm. What their claim to fame is that you can have there's 108 different playable characters that you can have in your
party. I'm saying, what's that word? What's a Suikoden?
Yeah, does Aaron know?
It's like, what would I have to look up the kanji? It's like water or something, right?
Know. Is it about the ocean?
No,
I don't think so.
Fantasy water margin. There you go.
Gensou Suikoden. Like, PS1 is, like, I played RPGs, 16-bit RPGs, but I got a little bit older and I was a teenager when the PS1 came out, and that was, like, peak Justin Davis playing RPGs. Like, I played all of them. So it's, like, it's a little bit hard for me to, like, contain myself when I think about Grandia and Parasite Eve and...
Did you play Vagrant Story?
Yeah, Vagrant Story.
Xenogears also on the PlayStation.
Oh, my God, they're also good. They're also good. Star Ocean 2.
And Chrono Cross.
Ah, Chrono Cross 2.
Yeah. For me, the other one that I have to specifically shout out is Grandia. I've talked about it on the show before. I think to this day it has the greatest battle system in any RPG of all time. Everyone is kind of on one timeline, and when they reach the end of the timeline, then they attack. But if you catch them right before they attack, you can interrupt them, and it resets them back on the timeline and, like, interrupts and cancels their attack. And you can sacrifice, like, a move that charges up more slowly, but it's really powerful, but then you run the risk of getting interrupted. So it's like, it's a great sort of semi-real-time battle system, and the storyline is just really kind of, it's very simple. It's like we're going on an adventure, but it does it in a way that feels very heartwarming, and it's like a warm blanket.
Mm-hmm. What about Mega Man Legends? Was that any good?
I never played it.
I never played that one.
It's an RPG. People freak out for it. It is. It is the Mega Man RPG.
I'm not saying
everything
it's not.
Everything is an RPG, Sam.
It is.
Well, speaking of that, I was going to throw you for a loop. Is Castlevania Symphony of the Night an RPG?
No.
Even though you earn all that experience and numbers fly out of everything? Your loot?
If you look up best RPG lists on the internet, you're going to find some kooky stuff included. And, like, Ocarina of Time, like, slips into RPG lists because Nintendo itself called it an RPG. And they only called it that because they didn't have any RPGs on the N64.
Yeah.
And so,
yeah, well, we'll get to that in a minute.
I understand the argument of, like, your character levels up in Castlevania and you get new equipment and, like, you get stronger. But it's like, I don't care. It's like everyone, like, we all understand what we're talking about when we're talking about role-playing games. And, like, a role-playing game could have real-time combat, but, like, come on, like, characters line up and they fight each other. And like, we all know what an RPG is.
Okay, we will not count Symphony of the Night then. Well, it sounds like it's going to be hard to narrow this down to three then. What are the top three?
I mean,
you've played a lot that I've actually never played.
Well, you know, look, it's a little bit of a contrarian opinion that I leave 7 out. I just personally think it's overrated. But, like, obviously Final Fantasy 7 is, like, the iconic PS1 RPG, right? Yep. So... you know, 7, 9, Suikoden, Grandia. I'm going to say it's those four.
Okay. Doing four for that one.
Pear. Four out of three.
Any pushback from you, Pear?
No, look, I wasn't a Suikoden guy, and I was working full-time on covering the Nintendo 64 at the time, and so I didn't go as deep into the PlayStation RPG library as I would have loved to. I think in the end, like, 7 just still deserves the top spot. And, like, by the way, there were a lot of things I was pissed off about going from Final Fantasy 6 to 7. I felt like the world felt really uninteresting and non-interactive to me after 6. Not that you can interact with a lot of stuff, but, like, you could, like, grab something and pull on it, at least in that world. And it felt like you were in that world. And I always felt like Seven, it felt like you were so superimposed on the pre-rendered backgrounds. But no, Seven story-wise, and come on, that soundtrack, amazing.
So, the soundtrack's really good. So you miss Suikoden entirely, Pear. Would you call that your fantasy water margin?
Yeah, there you go.
Whoa.
Well, Pear, the Nintendo 64 did have an ogre battle.
That it did. It had the person of lordly caliber. A title that rolls right off the top.
People love that game. I think it's a worthy RPG.
Really good. Like and it's honestly, I mean, that I write this monthly column on Forgotten Gems, and it's on my list to cover, like, Ogre Battle, because Ogre Battle has split into two series, right? One is Tactics and one is Ogre Battle, the proper one that started on the Super Nintendo. We got one on the Neo Geo Pocket Color, which was really good. It was a very different game. It's kind of, you can't call it an RTS either. It's like units move in real time, but when they meet, it's like traditional RPG battles. It's not like StarCraft where they start like hitting and shooting each other. I would put Ogre Battle on the list. The N64 was a terrible platform for role-playing games. RPG developers at the time said, we love CDs, we want pre-rendered cutscenes, our games are about storytelling, and they did not like the idea of doing their story sequences in-game, in-engine. And so really, a lot of them skipped the N64. They also really liked Red Book Audio. Remember that old term, lads? Yep. So the best RPG on N64 is
Paper Mario.
Paper Mario, hands down. I would put number two, Ogre Battle 64. I would put number three, a little-known game called Hybrid Heaven from Konami. It was kind of like a Blade Runner-esque game. Cool. Had a really weird combat system, fully polygonal graphics, but Paper Mario by far was the best one.
What's Quest 64 like?
Oh my god, that would be number 99 on the list of RPGs.
What is
N64?
It was meant to be like a kiddie RPG.
Super simple. The hero's name is Brian. You know, when you think about RPGs, like, you really think about Brian's. It was a very simple role-playing game. It's charming. It's not terrible, but it's like, it's really like explore, find a treasure chest, open a treasure chest, encounter some slimes, and do battle. There were a couple of games that didn't come out here that I think we should mention. Custom Robo 1 and V2. That was Nintendo. It wasn't Nintendo in-house developed. It was a second party. But Custom Robo are basically like almost Pokemon-like in their setup, but you do real-time battles where you build your own robot and you fight others. They're really cool games. I don't know why that series died and just never took off over here. Those games didn't come out over here. And then there was a game you guys may know as Shirin the Wanderer. It's whole mysterious dungeon series. It was called Fushigi no Dungeon Furai no Shirin 2. That one was really good. It came out on N64 in Japan, never came out here.
Was Shirin the Wanderer the first game on PlayStation?
Was it on Super Famicom? It might have been there.
I think it was. I think it was 16-bit, but I can't recall. 16.
But yeah, it's like every Japanese RPG maker tried something on N64, except obviously Square and Nintendo didn't see eye to eye in those days. But it's just that platform. Nope, not for RPGs, which is why we got advertisements saying Ocarina of Time was the greatest RPG of all time and all that.
Paper Mario, I think, is underrated it's the first game I can think of from Nintendo that was kind of like, you know, subversive and like poking fun at, like, you could find these weird Luigi diaries of like that whole meme of like just the weirdness surrounding Luigi got its start, and like you know, like the sidekicks being enemies, and like Nintendo, that's like a strain of Nintendo that carries through to the modern day of like sometimes the company plays it really straight up and like family friendly, but there's this edge sometimes in some of their writing of like, you know, this wink if you understand kind of writing in some of their stuff that I don't remember before Paper Mario.
So I was covering the N64 beat when that was still known as Mario RPG 2. That was supposed to be the sequel to the Square Enix developed game. And then obviously that entire relationship fell apart. But I remember renders of what Final Fantasy VII would look like on N64 too. It was
so
all
cool.
Like chibi polygonal models at the time, more like Final Fantasy VI. And then it all fell apart, and then Mario RPG 2 turned into Paper Mario. And I think part of that was, one, a break from that Square Enix relationship and that title, Nintendo wanting to own it outright. Two, everybody was struggling with the hardware, and Nintendo was using using sprites for that game. And I think they just stumbled upon the fact that it looked like little paper cutouts and you could flip them and be funny. Mm-hmm. So that's how we ended up with the paper theme.
And Nintendo wouldn't get another Final Fantasy until Crystal Chronicles on the GameCube.
Yeah, and I would argue that's not really a Final Fantasy.
My shortlist for the Game Boy Advance was Mario and Luigi Superstar Saga, mm-hmm. Final Fantasy Tactics Advance, and Tactics Ogre, The Knight of Lotus.
Not okay. A Golden Sun fan.
Yeah, you're missing Golden Sun.
I just haven't played Golden Sun.
So. Okay. Yeah, those are
good. I can already see.
They're not amazing.
I think they're overrated. They have.
I agree.
Here's the thing: is they're not bad at all. They're really good, like 8 out of 10 RPGs. But they're very like straight up. Like it's just like a very traditional sort of like going on an adventure, collecting a party of people, and defeating evil role playing game. Like in my opinion,
you're talking about Mario and Luigi.
No, Golden Sun.
Golden Sun. Okay, gotcha.
I think they're well executed. They're really well done. But I also, in my opinion, don't think they're like exceptional in any way.
Yeah, there's some cool stuff. I mean, obviously, we still got the Pokemon games on GBA, right? And they were all quality titles. They didn't do a lot of new. They expanded on the Game Boy titles. But there were some. I mean, Fire Emblem finally came to the West on the GBA. It's a tactical role-playing game, not core role-playing, a little bit more strategy and chess than RPG, I would argue. Love those games dearly. But we also had, you guys remember, was it Boktai?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
The Kojima game with a built-in sun sensor. So,
super
and
cool.
Boktai 2 also came out. There's some really cool experiments on the GBA. I actually thought it was a pretty successful platform for role-playing games. It got, you know, Final Fantasy games got re-released.
Yeah,
the Super NES era got re-released. And then in Japan got Mother 3, right? Which was meant to be Earthbound 64, ran into trouble, never came out on that platform, and then was given to Brownie Brown to finish. But it retains a lot of the ideas and the scenarios from the 64 version.
I mean, I brought it up on Scoop a couple months ago when my airplane game was this game called Summon Knight Swordcraft Story,
which is
a really, really cool GBA action RPG where all the combat was played almost like a 2D fighting game. It shifted into the side scrolling view. And then they're really beloved. I never got as into them, but the Mega Man Battle Network games got their start on the GBA.
Mm-hmm. I never got into those either. But yeah, Golden Sun is a really interesting story where it's like it was one of the earlier kind of really traditional JRPG games without a whimsical Mario theme or something. And it was, I really loved it when I played it, but they were kind of rote, right? They were very straightforward and like paint by numbers in a lot of ways, but I still like them. I want to replay them.
Sam, any games sad?
No, I didn't. I'm, you know, Pear was just mentioning that he thinks that the RPGs did pretty good on the GBA. That system deserved 5 times the amount of RPGs that were on it. Like, that was the last system that had really good sprite work until the resurgence of sprite work recently, which is awesome and you know, tied with RPGs. But in terms of, like, original big JRPGs with stories that would have picked up after, you know, those kind of became CD-ROM games. And I'm just like a little disappointed with the GBA, and I didn't play any of those games.
I think I never played
games.
I think that the Kingdom Hearts spinoff on the GBA is a role playing game that's pretty well liked, but yeah. I haven't played it.
And there's a Final Fantasy Tactics on GBA,
That was on my short list. Yeah.
Yeah. If you look at the Japanese market, right? Like if you like Mario and Luigi Superstar Saga, that's Alpha Dream made that one, and they made a game called Tomato Adventure in Japan. Mm-hmm. You know, like besides Mother, the Mother games, Mother 1 and 2 got re-released on the GBA in this combo cartridge, and there's an absolutely gorgeous Game Boy Micro, which I own.
Hell yeah.
You know, like between Tactics Ogre was on the machine, Tales of the World was on the machine, the Super Robot Wars, Super Robot Tyson games were on the machine, Shining Soul, Lufia, Breath of Fire. There's so much on that that box. Yep.
So would you
ports?
Yeah,
lots of ports. Yeah.
Would you replace any of these? Superstar Saga, Final Fantasy Tactics Advance, or Tactics Ogre?
No, that's a good list.
I don't think that SRPGs belong on this list.
Yeah, that's I'm struggling with that. I like Fire Emblem is one of my favorite series of all time, but they're different, right?
Yeah, we've included many of these on the list already.
Too late now, Dustin.
Really?
I think the Mario and Luigi games are terrible. They're so
I love Superstar Saga.
They're fun for 8 hours. They're fun for 8 hours, but they're 25 hours long. They just go on forever, and you're like, okay, am I really going to jump on this turtle at the start of every single battle for the rest of my life?
Well, yeah, it's revolutionary.
Instead from now on, every song Fire Emblem. Then.
Instead of just pressing A to attack, you press A, and then you press it again right when they bop the guy. Kabam! You do bonus damage, and it feels so good. It never gets old.
Yep.
The PlayStation 2 will be interesting.
Will it? I mean,
what's the best Final Fantasy on PlayStation 2? Maybe that's a good place to be in.
12.
This is going to be controversial.
12? I mean, people love 10 and 10-2. I just never played them myself.
I like 10 best.
Oh, wow.
I just think people were annoyed with some of the voice acting, like Waka ground people's gears. I love Final Fantasy X. I thought the story was beautiful, and there were so many amazing moments in that game. Yeah, Blitzball sucks, whatever. it's a great game. I love those characters so much more than any of the white bread blonde people that came later. And it really showed me what the next generation of role-playing games could be like. Like, you know, the voice acting, cinematic scenes rendered in-engine. That soundtrack is fantastic. Like, you know, the Sticky Dane song, all of that is freaking amazing. I love that game. And it's one of those games, like, when it came out, everybody loved it. And then over the years, more and more naysayers cropped up. It's just, you have to see it as a product of its time. Of course, the performances are not going to be as good as a modern RPG and what followed. I would still put that one first.
Nice.
But there's more.
Is Dragon Quest VIII?
Yeah, really good.
Yep, it's good.
That's the Journey of the Cursed King. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, that game's great.
Big 3D one.
I would put, honestly, my top three, I would put Baldur's Gate, Dark Alliance, but it's one of those games that was on every platform, so it's not really defining the PlayStation 2.
Well, but that's okay, because like, as we'll see with the 360 and PS3, there's going to be overlap there.
Yeah, and then Champions of Norrath, like a rare non-JRPG on the platform that was really good. But I actually have a real soft spot for the two Dark Cloud games, too. Did you guys play those?
I was going to say Dark Cloud, too.
Yeah. So there was on the Super NES, I think it came out in the West. Yeah, so it was called Soul Blazer in Japan, Soul Blazer over here, which was an action game with RPG elements, action adventure, where you build your town, and Dark Cloud like really scratched that itch, where you had this sort of, you know, town world building feature in addition to all the questing and all that.
It's also really beautiful. It's got sort of cartoony graphics, a little bit like Dragon Quest. And so it holds up, right? Like, it still looks beautiful to this day.
I love these ancient hyper-compressed IGN videos. That
this is how it looked.
I don't know if any of us on this show are Persona boys, but like Persona 4, was originally a PS2 game. And, you know, Persona 4 Golden is like the sort of re-release and remake is the one that people remember.
Persona 3, And then, I'm not a giant Kingdom Hearts fan.
But that's like the height of Kingdom Hearts,
action
right?
Action-oriented, but two. Kingdom Hearts 2 is was a massive one, obviously.
Yeah, huge game.
On my RPG backlog, which, like, it's become comical. Like, I'm never in my life going to get to these games. But, like, I haven't played Shadow Hearts Covenant. Like, the Shadow Hearts games on the PS2 are really beloved and really well-liked by people that know. But I just, I haven't gotten to it.
I, for some reason, got really into Odin Sphere. Bought that game.
Yeah, game's awesome.
Really liked it.
That's a great game.
Yeah.
Yeah, it looked. Is that Atlas that did that one?
I don't know.
It's vanillaware.
I was gonna say it's vanillaware. Yeah,
vanillaware. Okay.
They're still making that. They're still like remaking Odin Sphere to this day.
They did other games on the PS2 that weren't like Odin Sphere. I don't know them very well.
Yeah, Muramasa, one of their games, the Demon Blade.
Oh yeah, the Demon Blade.
I played that too.
It's hard to narrow this down to three. Then
I really could appreciate be two Final Fantasies. I like Final Fantasy 12.
You can do 10, 12, and one other, right?
the battle system in 12 is divisive, but I think it's awesome and really satisfying, and like just getting all your characters set up. Like the combat plays out in real time, but you can set up rules for your characters of like, if I'm under 50% health, use a potion, or if like this buff falls off, rebuff my party. And then people are like, "Ooh, like the game plays itself." But like, A, all mm-hmm. those different rules like have to be unlocked. Mm-hmm. And like, I found that really satisfying and cool. It's like you get more, like in the beginning, you only have kind of broad control over your party, but it gets more and more granular as you get deeper into the game of like, you know, now I can say, you know, okay, heal myself when I'm under 50% health. But if I'm under 10% health, I have an oh shit button of like do something, you know, panicky before you die. And like then setting it all up perfectly and like letting your party just go off and do their thing is like just such a deeply satisfying thing that like Pillars of Eternity has a system like that too. But like it's not really ever been repeated. And, you know, like the story and characters, like, you know, Vaughn kind of sucks, but like Tidus kind of sucks in 10 too. So, you know, whatever. I remember the game as having satisfying gameplay and combat, and I don't care. Other people praise the game for kind of its world building and stuff like that, but that's not what did it for me.
Yeah, cool. Definitely cool art. I mean, I could see 10, 12 and Baldur's Gate.
Oh, that's what I was going to what I was going to suggest.
I would 10, put 12 and Baldur's Dark Gate. Dark Alliance on it.
On the GameCube, there's a Fire Emblem.
There is a really good good Fire Emblem that nobody played, and they didn't make a lot of copies, therefore if you own the disc like I do, you can eBay it for quite a pretty penny.
Mm-hmm. I mean, are we skipping? So it's like, you
is
know.
Is that Radiant Dawn on GameCube?
It's called Path of Radiance.
Path of Radiance. Okay.
I mean, look, GameCube got the best Paper Mario. Paper Mario.
Thousand Year Door.
The Thousand Year Door. I would put that one at the top. And then it got a whole bunch of re-releases of, you know, remember there's the age that Sega became console agnostic. It's a year that
so we got Skies of Arcadia Legends, which, you know, is a Dreamcast game, but I think it count. I think we can count it as a GameCube, you know, RPG because it wasn't just a port. It sort of cleaned up and fixed. Like I think Skies of Arcadia on the Dreamcast has the most insane random battle rate I've ever seen. Like you will literally, like if you're trying to go from here to there, you will fight 100 battles. Yeah. Like it's completely crazy, and it's still a little bit bad in the GameCube version, but they cleaned it up and added some systems to the game that I think make it one of the all-time greats on the GameCube.
It's a bit, yeah, it's definitely the better version. And then Tales of Symphonia was also on the GameCube, but Reb would kill me. I didn't say Bait and Kados. Obviously, coming back. I mean, that's her Live Alive moment. Like she never thought these games would be brought back, but yeah, Bait and Kados is it's a card RPG. That was the thing that irked me at first when I started to play it, and then I liked the game quite a bit.
Well, if it's a card RPG, now you have my attention.
You haven't played those?
I haven't played it.
I never played the sequel. I only played the first one.
So yeah, what has to go? If we want Thousand Year Door, there's also Fire Emblem, there's Skies of Arcadia. How do you fit Bait and Kados in there?
I think Bait and Kados and Thousand Year Door are probably shoe-ins, and then it's really a fight for kind of third place, probably between like Tales of Symphonia or like Skies of Arcadia. And I don't care actually. I would give it to either one of those. They're both great.
Just one of those.
I like Tales of Symphonia better. If we're disqualifying, you know, Path of Radiance, Fire Emblem is freaking awesome.
I like Skies more because it's got Sky Pirates in it, and that's just a real, you know, it's just cool. It's a cool video game thing. There's certain stereotypes that like supersede their stereotypicalness, and then it's just like, oh, it's just neat. And like for me, that's Sky Pirates. It's like Marge Simpson holding the potato, and she's like, I just think they're neat. That's me with Sky Pirates.
Thousand Year Door, Bait and Kados, Skies of Arcadia Legends. Cool.
There you go.
The Xbox saw the return of Western RPGs on consoles.
We had KOTOR,
Elder Scrolls 3, Fable, and Jade Empire.
Morrowind.
I was wondering if you were going to bring up Jade Empire. Forgotten Gem.
Forgotten Gem. I believe it's a 9.7 from IGN.
Yeah, it's too high.
That is too high.
But KOTOR... it was a rare role-playing game. That's BioWare, by the way, right? Yeah. So they went from making Knights of the Old Republic to making a game entirely with a Chinese kind of martial arts, you know, theme. And so the combat was centered around a lot of the hand-to-hand combat, which was a departure from everything else. It's a really good game.
What did anyone argue with? I mean, KOTOR's got to be number one.
Yeah. KOTOR's got to be number one.
And Morrowind and Fable? That sound pretty good?
Oh, interesting.
I'm not a Fable guy. I would put Jade Empire above Fable, but Morrowind definitely would be my number two.
Mm-hmm. Fable is also borderline whether it's a role-playing game or not, in my opinion. Okay. Which,
KOTOR,
you know,
Morrowind and Jade Empire.
KOTOR, I think, is, and I know that PC role-playing games have been doing this from the beginning, it's the first role-playing game I can remember where it's like, you can be good or you can be evil, you know? and it's cartoony by modern standards. It's like, do you want to save these people or torture them? But like, that was still like, that was interesting to me at the time. Like, I can't recall, you know, compared to all the other role-playing games we're talking about, like, you can't do that shit in Tales of Symphonia, that's for sure.
For sure. Yeah, and Xbox had a lot of good Western RPGs, and obviously Dark Alliance was also on the Xbox, but we already picked that one for PS2, so.
I think we can do 360 and PS3 at the same time because there's so much overlap, and I think it's got to be Skyrim and Mass Effect 2 and one of the Fallouts.
Yeah, I'm a 3 guy. I didn't ever like the setting of Fallout 4, or I'm sorry, of New Vegas. I just thought it was kind of boring. But I thought DC was really fun to explore, but I understand the mechanical arguments for 4 and the story and stuff like that. But 3 is just like really interesting to me. I love the United States lore in it.
So I think New Vegas is so good.
Yeah, New Vegas is, that's the original Fallout boys coming back and basically doing, you know, taking the new approach of Fallout 3. And it was such a cool story, right? Like, it's almost Red Dead Redemption like in how the story is told. And ultimately, I do think it's the better game. I spent way more time with Fallout 3.
Do you like brown or gray better?
Yeah, no, for sure.
I think that like some of the faction storytelling in New Vegas and, you know, just the reactivity of the game world and just your options for like, you know, I played that game maybe 3 times over the years, and every once in a while I stumble on a YouTube video where it's like, I didn't know you could do that. Like, just weird ways you can double cross people and complete quests in unusual ways. Like, it's so good for that.
So I would definitely say, you know, Mass Effect, Fallout, one of the Fallouts, and, you know, Oblivion maybe on the Xbox 360, but I do want to decouple the PlayStation 3.
You pick Oblivion over Skyrim?
I'd pick Skyrim.
Oh, that's right. Skyrim came out that far back.
Yeah, I know.
Okay, it's that really, I really liked Oblivion, but no, I liked Skyrim better. I agree with you, but we have to decouple PlayStation 3 because it had Persona 5, and that's going to be number one on that platform.
Yeah.
I played it on PS4. That's just what I think of it as, but okay, sure.
Everything gets, I don't know if it's because it's more recent or, you know, but like, I feel like there's more blurring and blending, like Divinity 2 came to those consoles, right? Like, you know, and most people, like, I think of that as a computer RPG, but like, you know, but the console ports were good. Like Diablo 3 is on those consoles, you know, so it becomes really hard to like separate out that stuff.
Near? That is tough. Diablo 3 to me is a PC game.
Yeah, that helps, right? Is to say, like, what games do people prefer to play on PC at the time? And that might apply to Fallout a little bit, but man, those games were total console RPGs for a lot of people. So was Mass Effect.
What you have South Park, The Stick of Truth.
Yep.
Stick of Truth.
That is another. I know
it's really good. It like punches so far above its weight from like both a gameplay and sort of like, you know, just scenario design. Like it's really great.
But then there's Dragon Ages on that system too, right? And probably Dragon's Dogma.
That got our Game of the Year, Dragon Age. But like within Mass Effect,
that
even,
one was on a later system.
I see. Dragon would you pick Mass Effect or Mass Effect 2?
I think
2 is better. 2 is better.
Sure. Just making sure.
Yeah. Yeah. There's Deus Ex Human Revolution. Is that a role-playing game?
Oh, man, yeah. Yep.
Yep, I think it's very good, just maybe not quite as good as some of these other games.
For sure.
We're going to have to speed things up. Starting to run out of time. On Nintendo DS, so many games. Dragon Quest IX, Final Fantasy Tactics, A2, The World Ends With You, Fire Emblem Shadow Dragon, Mario and Luigi Bowser's Inside Story.
Don't forget about BioWare's big entry, Sonic RPG.
Yep, there is the Sonic RPG.
Yeah.
I think Pokemon Black and White is my favorite Pokemon. That's on that system. I think it's really, really good. Black and White 2 was a weird direct sequel on DS. And then a Chrono Trigger came out for DS that's better than the original.
That's right. Yeah, it got everything. The DS was another really powerful RPG system.
But a port of Chrono Trigger, right?
And it got all the 3D remakes. It had Final Fantasy IV 3D remake. Shadow Dragon is awesome, obviously. Wow, that's a tough one.
It is. It's a really like sort of stealthily strong RPG console. I would shout out Rune Factory, which is it's where those games got their start. There's a few of them on the DS. There's sort of a fan. Actually, I think that was the subtitle. It was like Rune Factory : A Fantasy Harvest Moon. But like that's the pitch, right? Like Harvest Moon in a fantasy world, and they're great.
Yeah, I mean for me, Dragon Quest IX, hands down, best RPG on the platform.
Yeah, I would do that. And we can't really include Chrono Trigger, so maybe DQ9. Does anybody here like World's Ends with You? That's some people's favorite game of all time.
Yes. Yeah, I know. That's got to be number two for me.
Yeah,
I
agree. There you go.
Yeah.
Wait, so Dragon Quest IX, The World Ends with You, and Pokemon Black and White?
I would throw in a Pokemon by this point. We haven't had a Pokemon in a while, and there's but we don't need to. I mean, X and Y also came out in that system.
Diamond and Pearl.
Diamond and Pearl. That's what it was. Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, we're not like this panel is not huge Pokemon people, so you know, whichever one is the good one on the DS. That's
I mean, good since I did the guides for all of them starting at this one, which was like a lot of work, and so like I really remember Black and White 2. In contrast to the 3DS ones, I just think let me say it this way: the Pokemon were better in Black and White 1 than in any previous Pokemon edition except for the first. So the next 100 were like, okay, then they had some more, and then the Black and White ones are crazy and fun. That's where you get Chandelure, which is a chandelier Pokemon. You get Lampwick, like a little, or Litwick, I forget the name of that little candle. You get a freaking keychain named Klefki.
It's just them. They're like, we need 8 more Pokemon.
A big bag of garbage. Hey, what about an ice cream cone? Vanillux? Like, it's incredible. It's just some of the best designs they ever did. They got a little boring after that.
I really like Dragon Quest Monsters on the DS too.
Yeah. Well, look.
What
I
game
like
is that? Did that come out in GameCube also or something? Wii, right?
Yeah, I don't know. The DS one is the one I remember. It's like Pokemon, but in Dragon Quest world, where you collect all the Dragon Quest monsters and then level them up and they fight for you.
Okay. What about Rocket Slime? That was a fun game.
Rocket Slime's so good.
I'm cool with the first list you mentioned, the ranking you mentioned. Okay. Like Fire Emblem Shadow Dragon is a remake of the original, so. Mm-hmm.
Well, you mentioned the Wii, Sam. The Wii had Xenoblade Chronicles. It has Super Paper Mario. And don't laugh, but I would make a case for Chocobo's Dungeon.
Super Paper Mario is the least RPG version of Paper Mario.
Is that true?
Yeah.
That
you can't include that one. No. It had some unique games, like remember The Last Story was on the Wii.
That's what I was gonna shout out too. Right? I never played it, but the Final Fantasy creator, Hironobu Sakaguchi, you know, left Square and made The Last Story, which is always to this day made me laugh because he made Final Fantasy and then
There's also Little King's Story, which people flip their crap for.
Mm-hmm. It's really great. Borderline if it's an RPG. It's like Pikmin combined with a town builder and city builder.
I feel like the defining Wii RPG, and we brought up Baton Kaitos, right? Like Monolith Soft became a Nintendo company and made Xenoblade Chronicles and started a good thing on the Wii.
It's gotta be Xenoblade Chronicles.
Yeah, so that one I think I would put as number one. Mm. Dragon Quest X was on the Wii too.
We don't need to do 2 or 3.
Yeah. I think on the Wii U, it can only be a Mass Effect 3.
Wait a second. Xenoblade Chronicles X is on the Wii U. That's a great game.
Okay.
That's
sure.
So good. And then it had...
Is it very different from the first one?
Yeah. And then Tokyo Mirage Sessions FE. It is a really, really strange game. It's basically a Megami Tensei game.
I believe it's 200 hours long, too.
It's a strange crossover between the Megami Tensei Persona universe and Fire Emblem, but it is a bona fide RPG. Monster Hunter 3 Ultimate, if you consider the Monster Hunter series to be an RPG series.
I don't.
Certainly has enough menus.
And numbers.
Child of Light was on the Wii U too. That was good.
From Ubisoft. That was on the 360
also. Yeah.
Yep. That was good. That was great. Yeah, definitely not the RPG console or the anything console. Oh. Except for Nintendo Land, which is freaking awesome. The Wii U. The asymmetrical multiplayer.
You love Nintendo Land?
What? Oh, he loves it so much we lost him.
He just mic dropped at Nintendo Land.
Are we good?
Okay. Where are we picking back up?
Zero Fox Given.
For 3DS, just tell me if you object. Pokemon Sun and Moon, Fire Emblem Fates, and Persona Q.
I mean, yeah, kind of, but I also I recognize we got to move on. So, like,
well, is there something notable you want to mention though?
I would need like a cheat sheet. Let me see. I mean, Bravely Default. Come on, what? Like, Bravely Default was really good.
I mean, okay, is it better than those three?
Yeah.
Okay.
Look. I would say Fire Emblem Awakening is the best Fire Emblem. Sorry.
Yeah. So I have to be. I have to.
Same. I completely agree.
So wait. I just forget there are two different Fire Emblem games on 3DS.
Maybe three, but Fire Emblem Awakening is and one of them has three games in it. But Fire Emblem Awakening is the one with the babies, and it's the best Fire Emblem.
Okay.
It's a time travel story where you
as Lucina. It's awesome. So good.
Yeah, it's the best one. And it's the one that started this modern Fire Emblem of like a building, city building, and you know.
Limited in that one. It's not like that stupid academy where you have to have tea parties and stuff.
Wow. Oh my God.
Not the best
Fire Emblem Awakening then.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. For sure. Amazing game.
Essential. Also, Street Pass games.
Yeah. Oh man, I'm so nostalgic for
what's
the Street Pass
RPG one. It was fantastic.
Good. There was a dungeon crawling one.
The Street Pass Mii Plaza games. They all had really generic game names, right?
I nominate those for best of this list.
Okay. Fire Emblem Awakening, the Street Pass RPG, and Bravely Default. Sure.
You had
to argue with a rabbit to buy the Street Pass games. It's like, are you sure you want to buy them? I'm like, yo, just come on.
PS4 has Persona 5, Witcher 3, Dragon Quest 11, Final Fantasy 7 Remake, and Final Fantasy 14.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's Persona 5, Witcher 3, and maybe Dragon Quest 11.
Witcher 3 counts?
Why not?
I mean,
can we put Grand Theft Auto 5
there? Oh, no.
I don't think they're the same.
Look. What about Dragon Quest 11?
That's what I said.
Oh, dude, sorry, my bad. What, you got Yakuza Like a Dragon?
Yeah.
I think we should disqualify Witcher 3. And not because it's not a great game. It is an excellent game. But I think we can get a more RPG on the list, in my opinion.
Okay. Yeah. Persona 5, Dragon Quest
although
11.
We did... Yeah, I have to confess that we're being incredibly, you know, sort of like we totally let Skyrim slide right through. But then we're disqualifying Witcher 3. So it kind of makes no sense.
I think Skyrim's more of an RPG than Witcher.
100% much more. But like Witcher definitely is the start of this, you know, it's like what the Assassin's Creed games became until Mirage 2, which is mixing this sort of open world exploration with action. I would consider Witcher 3 an RPG too. Some people scoff at it. I love that game. I love Final Fantasy 15 too.
Me too.
It has an incredible soundtrack and I love the boys and
the
story. Yeah, I like that game a lot.
Justin likes that game too.
It's not going to not be on the list. It's like everybody's favorite game in the panel.
But there's some nuance there of like, I feel like Final Fantasy 15 is for me, but I love it and have a real soft spot for it in spite of like what I recognize as some of its objective flaws and why, you know, it's not more beloved more widely. So like, it's a little tough for me to like say, yes, it's a top tier Final Fantasy, even though like I'll never forget my time with it. I absolutely loved it.
Well, I think that's all that matters. I love the characters. I love the, you know, their different powers and how they're all flawed in their own ways. And
It bothers me that they all wear leather jackets and pants when they're clearly in the desert the entire game.
Look, it was trying a little hard and it doesn't wrap as well, right? Like it ends up giving you like after all this beautiful exploration and these quests, including a cup of noodle one, it goes yep. into a linear path. It does the worst possible thing you could be doing. It's a real bummer.
I have I a promotional really like cup of noodle from that game.
I've never, Damon and Sam, if you two never played it, I've never in my life played a game that more clearly, like the developers were like, oh my God, we got to get this game out. And like, it's so clear that that happened of like, you're in this giant open world for like 30 hours. And then like the game, like fast forwards, it's like 6 months later. And you're like, what? Like, what's going on? Who are you? Like what? And then the game just like, then the game just ends. Like, it's so weird. Man,
it should have got a director's cut.
Yeah. I mean, they tried and then they canceled it all.
Yeah.
I mean, I also have to shout out Dragon Age Inquisition.
What do you mean? There was a planned expansion?
Yeah, they were releasing all these chapters. They released four of them, and then they announced more. They're like, we're making this chapter and that chapter and this chapter, and then like 6 months later, they're like, just kidding, they're all canceled.
Yeah.
Like, and so I also have to shout out Dragon Age Inquisition. I think that game gets kind of a bad rap. Like Paris said, it's one of those games where like, after the fact, people have kind of come out of the woodwork and be like, oh, actually, it's not good at all. But like, I don't have a bad word to say about it. I love that game end to end. And, you know, love the characters, love the writing, love the exploration.
They had the opposite problem. They're like, you guys don't need to put this game out. And then it just lasts forever.
Yeah, it is.
We did give that game of the year. So maybe we should be Persona 5, Dragon Quest 11, and Dragon
And Cyberpunk.
Persona 5 Royal is not the PlayStation 4.
That's what makes it fun.
Wait, and what about Undertale? That's that era too.
Mm-hmm. I just never played it myself.
I do, and I associate. I mean, yes, it's on PS4. To me, it's a PC game. Yeah. I actually don't know how consoles do the twist at the end of Undertale because it's so PC specific. I won't spoil that.
Let's
here.
Not talk about that here. Nier Automata. That's it's action-y.
That's true.
You know, obviously Elden Ring, all that stuff, RPG elements.
I don't think of Elden Ring as an RPG.
For me, Witcher 3, I absolutely love that game. And the reason I love that game, even though, you know, its systems may not be as deep, and its combat, like people call it an action RPG, but I would say the action factor isn't actually that great. Like it's like the Elder Scrolls games where like it feels like there's lag between you issuing the command and the command being executed, which is more like traditional role-playing games. What I love about Witcher 3 is that it tells its best stories and side stories that are completely optional. And I just love the balls of creating a world, you know, and centered around, obviously, that's how the Witcher books are. And now Sam took one for the team and read them for us all and said they're terrible. Yeah. But like, they are about these like, almost like X-Files-like quests into investigating these phenomena and these monsters and things. And that Witcher 3 sends you on these side quests that are almost like novels in their own right. They're amazing little stories.
And you don't have to kill the monster. I've said this in GameScoop before. Sometimes the monster's like, but I'm not doing anything wrong. And Geralt's like, will you just like leave the village alone? And he's like, sure.
It's and then so then it's fine. Cool. It's to think that they wrote these amazing stories and went, it doesn't matter if you discover it or not. I just think that makes it one of the coolest games of all time. Mm-hmm. I love it. Yeah.
I do too.
There's a sequel coming out when we're all 70 and 80 years old.
There's like five more of them coming out, remakes and everything.
On Xbox One, I was going to say Witcher 3, Dragon Quest 11, and Divinity Original Sin 2. But I guess you could give that. It got Dragon Age Inquisition also, right?
Yep.
Yep.
Swap that out.
Yep.
On the Switch, I think it's again Dragon Quest 11, Divinity Original Sin 2, and Xenoblade Chronicles 3.
It's Mana Collection, Final Fantasy Collection, give me one other collection.
Switch has Live Alive.
And it has Live Alive.
Guys.
And Live Alive. There you go. That's it.
So
cut it off there.
So many good games.
Yeah, it's got Switch a lot of octopaths.
Yeah, I mean, Dragon Quest XI S, it's an amazing version of that game. Xenoblade Chronicles 2 is a fantastic RPG. Triangle Strategy, it's a nice little strategy RPG. A lot of people really like Octopath Traveler 2, which I have not yet played.
About I have Octopath not. Octopath Traveler 2.
That's in my backlog. Octopath Traveler is the worst version of Live Alive. So, you know, I did enjoy some of it, but I didn't think it was balanced as well. Not like Live Alive is balanced. It's like deliberately.
It doesn't need to be balanced. It's not the point.
I like Live Alive Remake. I like. We didn't count Monster Hunter, right? But it has Rise. And then Fire Emblem Three Houses is a lovely little game.
Mm-hmm. It's better than some previous ones.
Wow, look at you hating on the Fire Emblem.
And then Fire Emblem Engage also.
Oh, sorry. No, I like Engage. Three Houses sucks.
Yeah.
You didn't like Three Houses. Three Houses is like the Harry Potter Fire Emblem, right?
Yeah. I hate all the tea party stuff.
Oh my god, you guys! It hurts my heart.
I hate weird running around the academy. At least they made that smaller.
Oh no, they make you explore.
Make you explore. They make you go talk to people to get all the things you need for your battle.
Look, all that stuff is my favorite part about that game. Although I do have to admit, I think that Fire Emblem Three Houses is the only video game that I've literally fallen asleep playing.
The systems stack to a point where it can be really overwhelming. Yeah. And I think it's people like Sam that Nintendo listened to and said, intelligent system, tone it down a little bit, make that more optional. But I feel like they neutered it too much. I actually don't think Engage is as good as Three Houses.
You guys got too much time in your hands.
No.
Yep. Speaking of too much time,
Octopath. We gotta
wrap it up. Xbox Series, I think it's... There's this game called Chained Echoes that is apparently great.
Cyberpunk!
Yeah, in Cyberpunk.
Yeah.
I like Cyberpunk. And Diablo 4.
I love Cyberpunk. But that's interesting that you would call that an RPG and not The Witcher.
Because it is!
I also think The Witcher is. I would also probably put Mass Effect Legendary Edition on there.
Yeah. Diablo 4? Yeah,
man.
It seems like sentiment has kind of turned against Diablo 4.
It's just when people play these games that take over 100 hours and they get to the end game and they're mad that it doesn't add another 300 hours. I'm like, I'm already done. I just, you know.
Yeah.
Baldur's Gate is coming out for it eventually.
But Starfield's out next week, basically. So.
Yep. We'll have to redo the list probably, right? But yeah, a lot of re-releases, and like that's the weird thing about this generation. The lines are blurred so much between, you know, last gen and now gen. So
PS5, you know, it doesn't have Baldur's Gate 3 yet, but it has Chained Echoes and Diablo 4 and Final Fantasy 16. And Cyberpunk.
I really liked Final Fantasy 7 Remake.
Oh yeah. Yeah. Great game.
Mm-hmm. It's quite a different experience from the original, so I think it stands on its own and they both deserve to be played. Diablo 4 is obviously also on PlayStation 5.
Do you guys think it's sad though that the best RPG came out for the NES as Final Fantasy 1 and they've just never been able to top it? I mean, it's just like decades of not being able to top Final Fantasy 1. It's crazy.
You didn't get enough of a rise the first time around. So it's like, let's bring... I got to close out the show with it, too.
Warriors of Light. You know, the best thing about Final Fantasy 1 is that it doesn't have any story.
When office internet went out, I hear you talk crap about Nintendo Land, too. Stop it, Sam.
Unironically, in FF1, the glow up that your characters get
is from a weasel tail, Justin.
Yeah, it's good. It's a good moment.
Nice.
Well, there you have it. We didn't quite neatly pick three games for every platform, but we certainly did talk about a lot of really good RPGs.
I'm afraid... and declare it's definitive. The definitive list.
So you're saying our podcast about RPGs was talky and too long, but too many numbers. Is that what you're telling me?
Too many numbers. We've talked ourselves out of a video game 20 questions round this week. We're just out of time. My poor wife, we don't have any childcare today, and I can hear that she needs help in the other room, so I'm going to go and attend to that. But that's all the scoops that we have for you this week. Next week, your scoops will be coming from Germany.
Oh.
I'll be there. Per will be there. Maybe Per can be on if he hasn't skipped town yet. Yeah. Please be excited for that. Thank you, Sam. Thank you, Justin. Thank you, Per, for joining us today. Thank you to Tom, working behind the scenes to make this episode possible. My name is Damon. This is IGN GameScoop. We're out.
Talking shit about
Thanks, everyone. Thanks, everyone. Per.
See you later.
I'll see you downstairs, Sam. Thank you.
call that?
You sure about that?
That's a real puzzle in Baldur's Gate 3, by the way. It's like there's these statues that's like, yes, he faces the rising sun and he faces the setting sun. But they're facing the wrong way.
Damon, was that I think you should leave?
You sure about that?
Sure about that?
You sure about that?
But the one that just lives in my head now on repeat is, and I never talk.
What's that? Oh, yeah. I don't even remember.
That's like when he's
like a mime. He has this like stage show and everyone's just like, what are you doing? What is that? And I never talk.
That's become used in so many great jokes online.
Oh, I can just run away.
Get out of the way, I'm trying to do something.
I'm trying to do something.
I could just run away.
Sorry, it was.
I like the please is really funny, by the way, of like him. Like he's like, please, I'm trying to do something.
Okay. Here we go.